Now you know that part of our goal, is to have discernment, to have public discussion, and that's an odd thing today. We don't usually have discussions when we're not surrounded by people who all share our same opinion. So that's why we review every week. Now this is not a very controversial week, but we will have coming up some more spicy conversations. And so we like to just always review to remind ourselves, how do you have public conversations? So now you have to cheat real fast because I'm going to turn this over. And we're going to remind ourselves one of the seven principles for common discussions. They are?
Respect.
Listening.
Speak only for yourself.
Speak only for yourself. In other words, don't speak for all men or for all women or for all Lutherans or for all Catholics or something.
No judgment?
No judgment. Because you want to understand the other person's viewpoint. That's first thing is to say, why did they say that? It's such a crazy thing they said. I mean, I'm totally disagreement. But that's not the point. The point is why? What's behind it? It's often a deep experience or a viewpoint. And that's what we want to pick up. Next. Eighth commandment's the last one, right? Although in the one group they've also thrown in the fifth commandment, do not kill. Now we're not going to stick with the eighth commandment, which is to put the best construction. Someone says something. You see this in our political discourse, particularly. If a Democrat says something or a Republican, the other side immediately assumes the worst behind the decision. Right? The person must be a racist. The person must be only for wealthy people. And we don't assume that they have any good intentions behind the view. Here, eighth commandment says, put the best construction. Forgiveness and gratitude. Because people say things and you might be hurt. And we want to forgive them. They don't know they hurt you, but we forgive before we get in the car on the way home. So we're not holding on to that whole thing. And we're grateful when people share their views. Right? We actually want people. It's hard to get up in a public room and share your view on anything, right? Because you lend yourself to critique. So before we begin, it is Quilt Sunday. And Nancy, I've just asked Nancy to share this story because it's quite unique. And I thought it was a very powerful story. You're going to have to stand up, though, Nancy, and speak as loudly as you possibly can.
How many people were in the last service?
Oh, great. That was good. So I was at a Christmas party a year or so ago and met a young woman who was a psychology teacher out at the ELCA Lutheran School that is near Pepperdine University. And is that what it's called?
Yeah.
And there had been a shooting, if you recall, in a bar that the kids frequent, and some students had been injured and killed. And this person said to me, I was watching the students at this Lutheran college the day after the shooting, and they were walking around with these quilts on them. And she and I said, oh, I'm an ELCA Lutheran. And she said, well, the ELCA had, 2 days after the shooting, had shipped these quilts out to the students. And it wasn't cold out, but they were in shock and needing comfort. And they were all over campus, these beautiful quilts. So the ministries that we don't even know we're doing, right?
Thank you, Nancy.
Wow. Beautiful.
You don't have to be a comfort to wear a quilt in Southern California. But what a great image, right? So we are finishing up in James. First of all, look at the educational opportunities. You got those a little bit announced. Take this home and keep it. We've got Mondays with Emmanuel, which starts the Monday after the Super Bowl. We have special events like Angela Denker, who will be talking about Red State Christians, on the Wednesday after the Super Bowl. We have a special dinner only for women on March the 1st to talk about women in entrepreneurship. So if we really want that for women to come out, that will be special, only 40 tickets, if you want a small, intimate conversation. That will sell out, so I hope if you're interested that you'll buy those tickets and you should get them on our website. So today we're finishing up our talk about vocation that we've been discussing in January. And the reason is, I just want to review some of the things that we lifted up. I was not taught I was taught at the heart of the Reformation was justification by faith, right? The idea that we are saved by grace alone. And that's all that was stressed in my, not just in confirmation and in my church, but in my seminary training. No one ever talked to me about the power of vocation, the sense that God is calling us, that we've now been freed up. I've got God's favor. I've got God's favor because of Jesus. Now I get to serve the neighbor freely through various calls. The special Latin term for that is vocation. The German, anybody know German? It was called Berufung, the call. And so everybody in Germany after the Reformation went around saying, I've got a call. That's why we have vocational training, to discover your call, to be trained in the thing that God has wired you to be. Now, why are these two topics? This is something I'm going to come back and talk about over and over again here this year. Both the idea of the Evangelical Center and this vocation. And why is that important? Because I think there's been a great divorce between Sunday and Monday. For some people, you know, we have all this pious language. We talked about the mantle this morning. And for many people, that's just language for Sunday. It has very little to do with what I do Monday through Saturday. In fact, a lot of the language of Sunday can be imprisoned in Sunday and never break out and inform what we do on Monday. And that's the whole idea of vocation. We don't want the divorce between Sunday and Monday. What we do on those 2 days are bifurcated. So, vocation heals that. It connects Sunday with Monday. But it also answers the question, what was I saved for? Sometimes when I go to the communion table, right, it's all about me and Jesus. But obviously, there's a bigger question, what was I saved for? And scripture comes out that God is trying to build a new heaven and a new earth. God's trying to build a new humanity. In other words, you've been saved for a task, a big story that we've been invited to enter into. So, and Howard, if you could, we've got some chairs over here.
Great.
If you could point to free chairs so that people can get in.
We got some chair here. We've got one up front.
So we always ask the question, what were you saved for? Salvation, in other words, isn't the end of the game. It's opening up a whole new life of God's calling. Now here's, growing up, if you grew up in a Lutheran church, you heard this phrase, priesthood of all believers. What does that even mean?
Lutheran church. Methodist.
You heard it? Oh yeah, Methodists would have priesthood of all believers, absolutely. Presbyterians. What did that mean? We're all called. And not just to read scripture on Sunday morning, or to help with the liturgy. Sometimes it can get reduced to just participating. No, we've all got these calls. In fact, that's the vision of Isaiah, that we are all worker priests. In other words, we carry out our everyday work lives, but we do so now with a spiritual calling, like a priest. In fact, that was Luther's point. He took off the robes of his priesthood and he put it on his people. He said, now you have these great ecclesiastical orders, how you run your family, how you do your work and your job, how you live in the public square. He said, those are the most important religious orders that you've received. And so then he had, I'm sure everybody was not believing him. So he said, okay, which is more important? To wake up at 3 a.m. to say your monastic prayers, which is how he was trained as an Augustinian monk, or to get up at 3 a.m. to change your child's diapers? What was the right answer? He said it was the diapers, because that's your call. He said that prayer in the morning, that was just made up by the monks. It's not in scripture, it's a good discipline. But he said, my real calling, think about that, a man in the 16th century, right? I mean, it's to change those diapers. So he's trying to make the point that daily life is where we have this grand spiritual calling. And this, we'll have to do a whole session on this, but have you ever asked, why do we have communion every Sunday? Because most of us didn't growing up, right? It was once a month. Maybe twice a month when we were in our 30s, right? And a lot of traditions around us, very successful, very dynamic Christian traditions, hardly ever
Four times a year.
Four times a year was, yeah, that was the real pious Lutherans back in the day. Do you know why four times a year?
No.
Because Luther threw out a quip once. Yeah. Well, at least four times a year, and some people went, okay. Literally, it was that crazy. Because the sacraments, in many of these traditions, aren't that important. So worship is worship music and preaching, pretty much, and prayers. They don't have the. Why do we have it? Because there's a vision of the kingdom of God that we're being invited into. We use this grand and glorious language that we give up now all our skills and our abilities, our creativity, and that's represented by the bread and the wine, right? And our money, and we bring that all to the altar. That's us in the offering plate, and God takes it, he breaks it, he gives it back to the world and to us as his own body and blood. There's a vision of the kingdom of God that we've been invited into. When we celebrate communion, we are celebrating God's activity in the world on Monday. That's a big statement, I know. We have to talk more about it. But we're celebrating Monday and how God is now bringing us together in the kingdom of God. It's interesting, right? When we go to the altar, we go up there as Democrats and Republicans, right? As men and women. Think of any topic that would divide us. Right? Really. We can probably list here 10, 20 topics that divide us. Cultural issues, political issues, you name it. And around the table, Christ is building a new humanity that's united, despite all our differences. It's really a beautiful thing.
I just wondered, when you're preparing for communion and you're taking the wine, didn't Christ say, do this whenever you get together? As often as you get together.
Which is, there's a vision we're living out of our vision of the kingdom, which plays out. And therefore, we want to remind ourselves of the kingdom, because during the week, we can very easily forget the kingdom, right? Mm-hmm. And I'll talk a little bit more about that at the end, of where I am with that. Okay, so how does all this affect your prayer life? Does it affect your prayer life? Luther taught a certain discipline to prayer, which we are going to do in 15 minutes. Obviously, we need more time. But he said that actually the whole catechism was written and was supposed to be framed around vocation. Now, many of us learned the catechism when we were 14, 15, or 16, and so we weren't thinking about vocation, right? We were thinking other thoughts when we were 14, 15, and 16. Important thoughts, if I remember correctly. Luther said there are four communities who call you constantly. The God's call on your life is always happening in these four communities. And notice it's not just, oh, I feel called. It's rather the community's also calling me. And they change. And we all have a series of calls in these four communities, which are, the most obvious is the family. Because we all know you will always struggle with what your call is in your family. Because it's always changing. And it's always complex, right? When we were smaller, it was easier. I'm basically just the son of my mom and dad. It was kind of simple. Oh, yeah, and grandma would come and visit, you know. But then the older we get, sometimes we get married, and now we got two families we have to negotiate. And what is my role? But not just what my role is. We have bigger fish to fry here. What is my calling? You know, am I the one who hosts the family? Am I in charge of hospitality? Am I the peacemaker? Am I the truth teller? What's my role with the grandkids, or what my role as an uncle or an aunt? It's constant. This is where God's call is so important, as we know. The second is work, where we spend most of our time during the day. Now, this does not mean you're making a salary. Work is not always encumbered by salary. Which is important, right? Because I know a lot of retired people who are more busy today than they ever were when they were just trying to fill out a job description. Because now they're following their calls, so they're doing all sorts of things that they never had the time to do before. It's one of the great things about retirement. Retirement, by the way, is not a biblical word. You don't find it in Scripture. Because theologically, it does not exist in the kingdom of God. God is just constantly calling you to new ventures. in the community, the public square, what is your calling? Now, this is a little bit trickier because we don't often think about it that way. But here in the United States, I think we could say part of your calling, your responsibility, is, let's say, to vote. I would say another responsibility you have is to inform yourself about what's happening, and preferably with more than one source of information, right? Because now one source just won't do, used to, but I don't think you can trust just one source. You have to have multiple sources that you trust to inform you. But there are other things about if the public square is not functioning well, or it's functioning, what's your role? Are you to play a role in local government, or in your neighborhood, or maybe even at your club or your condo association or your apartment? I mean, what is your role in the public square? And then also in the church. And during stewardship, those who are on the stewardship committee, they're going to help us all discover what our role is, what our calling is here at the church. So these are four communities that are constantly engaging us with what's God's call. Okay, so here's what we're going to do. You have a sheet of paper. And I want you to have a pen, and if you could just open those up, those pens, those who haven't been passing around. Howard, if you could take one in the back here. This method comes from a woman in Chicago, Tracy Matthews. She has several of these. I like them because they're simple, but also because they build, I told her this week, she's teaching basically what Luther taught. Now, what Luther said is, in the morning when you get up and you say your prayers, you first would think about what your vocation is, what your calling was. And then you pray with the Ten Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, all in reference to your calling. Now, I'm going to say that again. So, let's say I'm thinking about my family. Right? Then I take the Ten Commandments and say, how am I doing with the Ten Commandments in reference to Nina, or my father, or my brothers, or my relatives? And so I go through the Ten Commandments as a help to review how I'm doing. And then, of course, if I'm not doing well in some areas, that's your time to repent and get God's forgiveness. So you can see what she's done here is she said, okay, first we're going to review what's good about your call. So let's say you choose the family. I'm going to have you in a second choose one of these four communities that you want to just focus on for this exercise. So if you take family, you say, okay, what is good? What am I pleased about with my family? What can I thank God for with my family? I've got two grandkids, by the way. That would be in that block because they just give like infinite joy. Who knew? Who knew? But there are other things. About my marriage, about my dad still being alive. There's things, and we want to take that seriously. What are we thankful for in this area of our callings and our families? But then, what is broken? And you notice we don't just say what's wrong. I mean, what's broken? Where has sin entered into my calling, into my family, that I want to confess before God? I mean, God knows the truth. We're just being honest with something God already knows. And I'm going to ask you right now, but, you know, if someone next to you is looking out, you know, on your, you don't have to write everything. Just write marks for yourself. No cheating, okay? We all have our own brokenness, okay? And then, of course, you lay those before God, and you say, God, what? Show me what I should do next, right? What's the next move that I should do? So I want you to do that now, just for a couple minutes. This is an exercise. Pick one of these four. Do you want to focus in on your family, on those relationships, on your work? And again, whether you're getting paid for it, or this is where you spend most of your time and efforts during the day, on the public square, or on the church. Just choose one. In fact, if you were doing prayers, you could choose one on Monday, one on Tuesday, one on Wednesday, one on Thursday, right? And just with this simple exercise, as you focus in on your call, what is good, what is broken, give that to God, and then pray, Lord, what's next? Teach me. Okay, we'll just take a few minutes and try that out. If anybody needs a Bible to write on, not to open and study, it's kind of hard to...